Hello and welcome back to another Penguin Magic Top 10. My name is Eric Tate. I'm the host of the Penguin Magic Podcast. Joining me today is Josh Birch. Today we are talking about something we get questions about a lot, which is magic for the blind. How can we perform magic for the visually impaired? This is a really interesting question because I know that I was at the Genie convention last year and someone came up to me and asked me what magic Penguin had that was best to perform for someone who was visually impaired. It was actually someone who wanted to perform magic for their parents, one of whom was visually impaired. And it draws an interesting question because I know that when I'm creating magic, it's usually coming from a personal experience perspective. And I wouldn't think to create magic for someone who is visually impaired, but I feel like the more and more gigs I do, the more and more I interact with people who do have, who are differently abled in some way, or they have a different way of experiencing the world from me, and it's important to be able to share magic with them as well. And I know you've thought a little bit about this.
Absolutely. So we all have different abilities and things, and we want to share our magic with everyone.
Yes.
And like you said, we get asked about this all the time on the forums, and people bring it up. How do you perform magic, which is usually kind of this visual medium?
Yes.
How do you perform magic for people who can't see as well as others?
But there really are some great effects out there that you don't have to see to experience. And I think you've actually got a pretty good list going up there. So let's start out with number 10. What do you think is number 10?
Yeah. So. So kind of the easy effects to think about are effects where you need to have somebody close their eyes. Mm-hmm. So you can involve people who may not be able to see very well if they just need to close their eyes for something. So the first effect that comes to mind is PK touches.
Oh, yeah.
So part of the deal with this, part of the challenge is as you're experiencing this, is this person who is standing with their eyes closed experiences magic, but they need to have that magic explained to them afterwards, which may not be ideal.
Yeah, in this case, you want to make sure that when you're performing a PK touches routine for someone who may be visually impaired, you want to be performing it for them with someone who they trust that
Absolutely.
Would not be making fun of them or anything like that.
Right.
So it is definitely one of those things where they can definitely experience that touch, and as long as they have the confirmation afterwards that clearly no one came near them, it can be a powerful effect in that way.
If you're not familiar with PK touches, you have two people on stage. You tap one generally on the shoulder, or you might touch them on the face, and the other person feels it. It's a super powerful effect and can be very personal. But like you said, it is kind of a trust thing. Even people who are just asked to close their eyes still may or may not trust it. So
I've seen people who have great vision absolutely not believe anything that was going on, and it killed the mood. So it's definitely one of those routines where you have to be able to establish trust between the person who is receiving the PK touches and the people who can see exactly what is going on. So I think in theory someone could do it, but it's definitely very situational.
Absolutely.
So I understand why it's low on the list at number 10.
Right.
Let's go with number 9.
Yeah, so a similar effect to PK touches where you generally either will turn off the lights or you'll have somebody close their eyes is powers of darkness. This is a little bit higher than PK touches because the amount of magic that the person actually experiences is a little bit more. So to give a synopsis of this effect, with powers of darkness, the magician usually has a ring or possibly a rope that is tied in a knot.
I think Mike Caveney does it with coat hangers, which is a really iconic way that he does it.
Right. And you would generally have the spectator either close their eyes or wear a blindfold, or they would turn off the lights. And the spectator, whoever's involved in the routine, would then feel all the magic happen to them.
Yeah.
So sometimes it's presented in a like a paper balls over the head type of feeling where everybody in the crowd sees what's happening, sees the secret, but the person involved does not. And so they get to experience the magic, which if I'm in a crowd and watching a magic show, I want to be that person on stage that's experiencing the most magic.
Powers of darkness routines have been prevented extremely seriously in like one-on-one situations or like one person with a crowd. And again, it falls under that like PK touches where in order for it to have maximum effect, they need to have somebody that they trust be there to verify everything. Because it's definitely one of those routines that doesn't live by itself very well.
Right. There is another effect out there. Well, there are very different. There are a whole bunch of different variations on this as well. So you mentioned the coat hangers.
Yeah.
Mike Caveney also has a version with just a rope that's been tied. Mm-hmm. There are versions with rings. There are versions with Justin Flom uses a frisbee with a hole in it. One of my favorite versions of this actually uses just a coin or a die. Mm-hmm. It's by Angelo Carbone. Mm-hmm. Carbone or Carbone. He performs where he has a coin in his hand, and it's very tactile, and you cause the coin to go from one hand to the other. But the method is you have to have them close their eyes, and even though they're holding your hands in place and they just felt the coin, the coin will pass from one hand to the other.
It's an interesting effect. Let's keep this rolling. Let's move on to number eight.
Number eight is alien mind reading.
Oh, this is one of those secret devices that allow you to put words inside people's heads, isn't
right.
it? Yeah, those are very interesting devices because you can definitely tell. For those of you who are not familiar with what I'm talking about here, this is literally a device that allows you to put noises in people's heads without a speaker. It's not like you're like quietly holding up like their earbuds to somebody's ears or something like that.
Right.
You actually hear it inside your head. I've been on the receiving ends of one of these before, and it's a really weird feeling.
It is weird.
And the nice thing is, when you are quote unquote hearing it, but you sort of intellectually know that you're not hearing it.
Right.
Like it's a super weird feeling.
You can plug your ears, you can hold your ears, and you can still hear whatever it is. It's like it appears inside of your head.
Yeah.
So this is presented, and there are various types of devices. My favorite that I think is kind of a solid device is the alien mind reading gimmick. Mm-hmm. They're usually used as some kind of a way to instant stooge somebody or to maybe this person thinks of a playing card and this person hears the card. That's all interesting and good, but I think for somebody who's visually impaired, this could be an effect. You could create an effect where they hear a thought of word or they hear something inside their mind.
Yeah.
It's kind of an effect by itself that you can hear something with your hands on your ears.
Yeah, and now we should sort of caveat this, that these devices are not always the least expensive.
Right.
Because it is using some pretty cutting edge technology that is just sort of like now coming into the consumer space where you can afford it.
Right.
But it's definitely, if you are wanting to play with some really wild stuff, these kinds of devices are fantastic.
Absolutely.
Let's keep it rolling. Let's see, that's number seven. Let's move to number six.
Number six is Taste Conditions by Morgan Strebler.
Oh, this is one of my favorite mentalism effects of all time. And this one is actually super interesting because this was specifically created for someone who is visually impaired.
Right. So I apparently, as you read in the book that this is covered in, Morgan talks about, I believe it's his brother-in-law who cannot see, and he was kind of perplexed. I'm a magician, and I'd like to show him some magic. But just the act of showing requires that you can see well, right? He created this kind of method that you can take a drink of some water and it slowly changes into another liquid inside the spectator's mouth.
It's really interesting. I went to a presentation. It was an art exhibition by someone who had a condition called synesthesia, and that's where your body interpret signals differently. So like you can hear colors
or
you can listen to numbers or you'll see taste. And when I found out about this, I started researching magic effects where I could cause synesthesia in people, and Taste Conditions was one of the first things that came to my mind because it is a really interesting approach to magic.
Right. It's not for everyone.
No.
Because you are going to ask your spectator to drink something.
You've got to have a very Morgan Strebler persona to be able to pull this off.
And I believe he, in the book, he covers changing water into mouthwash. Mm-hmm. I would probably do something like orange juice or something along those lines that could still be shocking.
Yeah.
But mouthwash doesn't seem super pleasant to have in your mouth. So it is something that's not going to work for everyone. That's why I put it kind of down lower on the list. But it's an interesting effect. It's an interesting approach. There aren't many effects where something you can cause something to happen inside their mouth.
Yeah, and it's one of those really interesting pieces that sort of stands by itself, because even if you're not going to do it, you can sit back and look at all of the construction that Morgan has put into this and all of the creativity that he has applied to it and go, wow, how can I take the lessons that Morgan learned from this and apply those same lessons to the way I create magic?
Right.
It's definitely, even if you don't do it, it's one of those tricks that is well worth reading about and discovering more of. Let's move on. Number five.
Number five is the silverware swindle.
The silverware swindle. This is a great one, and it's also, I feel like Jim Steinmeier made it very difficult to pronounce on purpose.
I know.
So tell us a little bit about the silverware swindle, because it's Jim Steinmeier is known for creating really, really clever things, and this is definitely falls into that category.
Absolutely. So this is in his books, Impossibilities. Mm-hmm. This is one of the effects that he includes. And it is a tactile effect. Mm-hmm. So with some of these effects that we've talked about, someone who is visually impaired can experience the magic or can be a part of the magic, but maybe they don't experience it, right? Mm-hmm. They can be a part of it, but they don't like feel it happen.
Yeah.
Well, with the silverware swindle, you could perform this on the phone. Mm-hmm. You could perform this online. You could perform this separated completely from them, from whoever you're performing for. And because everything is tactile and because it works by itself, they do all of the magic alone.
Yes.
So they can take the, what it is they take a set of forks and spoons and they separate them into two piles, and one fork or spoon or knife travels from one pile to another. And it's a super interesting effect. Everything kind of happens. It uses a little bit of psychological manipulation coupled with maybe a mathematical method.
Yeah, it is well worth looking at. And all of Jim Steinmeier's Impossibilities books are super interesting. And just even if you don't do anything from them, it's definitely like brain teaser candy that's worth reading. Let's move on to number four.
Number four is Holy Moly by Jay Sankey.
Oh, this is such a great effect. I was living in Canada when this came out, and it was so cool because it was I was able to get a hold of it before a lot of other people because he had spread it around to some of the shops up there. And so it's the cool, like, washer, the moving hole effect.
Right.
The props are really interesting and fun to play with, and Jay is really entertaining in the way he presents it.
So this is another effect that's very tactile again. It can have a visual moment, but it can be completely presented in the hands and just so that you touch things. It's done with washers.
Yeah.
And it has to do with moving the hole from a washer, from one washer to another. So you start off with a hole in a washer and you erase the hole. So it just becomes like this metal chip.
Yeah.
This metal coin. And then the other washer ends up having two holes.
Yes.
So it's the kind of thing that if I was performing for someone who couldn't see, then I would let them touch and handle the normal washers by themselves. And then I would place one washer in their hand and one washer in their other hand and cause that hole to pass from one hand to the other.
Yeah, Jay's got some really nice handling touches on that you can either play it like really, really crazy visual, or it can happen like in a tightly secured fist. I mean, Jay is really done a lot of good work on this.
Absolutely.
Let's move on to number three.
So number three is a PK effect that uses a coin by Jacques Poulin.
Oh, this is really good. I worked on the tutorial for his lecture, and it is one of the most visually stunning PK effects that you can do in someone else's hand, where the coin slowly turns over. It's not like it just like flips over. I mean, it slowly, like as slow as I'm going into my hand, turns right over. And it's really neat. It's a clever method that I think most people could get a hold of. But I could imagine if you were visually impaired, feeling the coin placed in your hand and then feeling the coin slowly turn over would just be a mind job.
Absolutely, absolutely. I remember we were at one of our Penguin Max conventions, mm-hmm. and Jack performed this for mm-hmm. a group of us. And Tim Toronto looks over to me, very knowledgeable magician. Mm-hmm. He looks over and says, "So he's using a thread, right?" Mm-hmm. And there's no threads.
Yeah.
There's no your spectator could hold their hand like this, and yep. the coin would still turn over. And it's just a super, super fun method.
Yeah.
Super powerful effect that they can mm-hmm. feel and see.
It takes a little bit of practice, but it's 100% worth it. It's made me sort of rethink some of my setups over the years because it's such a cool effect.
I forgot to mention at Penguin Max too, mm-hmm. he had a long sleeve shirt that he had rolled up the sleeves with. So it was a really interesting thing.
Yeah.
He kind of had the sleeves down here. Mm-hmm. And so the method is just clever enough
yeah.
that he was able to
you
perform
can,
it
you
in
can
a
find,
super deceptive way.
You can find more of the information in Jack's Penguin Live lecture,
absolutely.
Which is his live act, which is, it's really interesting. Okay, that brings us to number two.
So with number two, I chose a witch hand effect. Mm-hmm. Now there are two very similar witch hand effects, and I like them both, I've read them both. If you're into this kind of thing, I highly recommend that you check them both out, but they are both collections of witch hand effects. Mm-hmm. The first is V2 by Manos, mm-hmm. and the second is Tequila Hustler by Mark Elston.
I figured Tequila Hustler would come up in this. I knew Mark Elston's name was going to come up. I remember receiving my copy of it and just going, wow, Mark has done all of the work to like really get you there. And it is surprisingly deceptive, which
yeah.
is the cool part of it. It's because when you read it out loud, in your bedroom, when you're like, this will never work. And then you go do it at a bar and no one can figure out how it works. It's so good.
So the method is completely psychological. It's completely mm-hmm. in your head.
Yeah.
So usually when I perform it, I will pull out a coin and mm-hmm. say, here, take this coin behind your back, mix it up.
Yep.
Then with either of these effects, they're very similar. And the creators are aware of each other's effects. Mm-hmm. It's just a slightly different take. Mm-hmm. But you ask them to mix the coin back and forth in kind of a specific way.
Mm-hmm.
You ask a couple pointed questions, and you're able to tell which hand the coin is in.
Mm-hmm.
It's super interesting because you don't need a coin.
Yeah.
You can use just the thought of a coin.
Yes.
To narrow down one hand or the other. So if you're working with someone who can't see or who mm-hmm. might think that maybe you can use sight to manipulate mm-hmm. things. This is a piece of sleight of hand that happens
inside your head. It's so good. Right. It's so good. Everyone should pick up Tequila Hustler because
absolutely.
It's one of those things that, you know, if someone's going to ask you to do a trick and you don't have your deck of cards, you don't have your coins, you don't even have rubber bands, which why are you walking around without rubber bands if you're a magician? You're caught on, you know, you're on an episode of Survivor and you need to do a trick. Tequila Hustler is one that you can do anytime, anywhere.
Absolutely.
But that brings us to number one. Yeah. What is your number one effect in this list?
Number one, the effect that I turn to most often when mm-hmm. things are dark and I can't see and mm-hmm. things is our progressive anagrams.
Oh man, I recently saw a pretty well-known magician absolutely destroy a group with progressive anagrams.
Yeah.
I won't say who it is, but I was watching the show with someone, and it's my partner, and she could not understand or wrap her brain around how this person got that effect. And I think one of the true masters of progressive anagrams is, we're very fortunate to work with here at Penguin Magic, is Dan Harlan, who has done a ton of work.
Dan, so the names that you want to know are Dan Harlan, mm-hmm. Max Maven, mm-hmm. and Atlas Brookings.
Yes.
And if you haven't looked at the stuff that Atlas Brookings has put out, you need to go look at it.
Mm-hmm.
Max Maven did a lot of beginning work to kind of made progressive anagrams kind of popular in the early
yep.
90s. Atlas Brookings has expanded things. Dan has worked on so many of the little details
yes.
of progressive anagrams, so definitely look into their work. Reach out to customer service if you want to go for specific things. But the deal with a progressive anagram is you can do this. You can have somebody think of a superhero. Mm-hmm. And they're just thinking of that superhero. And then you name a couple letters,
yeah.
And you slowly spell that superhero's name, letter by letter,
yeah.
And then you can reveal that superhero's
name. It's really interesting because it's this fascinating combination of fishing and equivoque that work together in the method, the methodology and the words that are possible, that you can really do some very direct mind reading and eliminate a lot of the problems that fishing has with multiple outs. Because you're still using multiple outs, but the multiple outs script themselves so that you seem like you're just spot on every time. And it's so good. And I was just gonna say, and you are 100% right on Dan Harlan working a lot of the details, because there was a lot of heavy lifting that was done mm-hmm. to get those structures in place, and then Dan came in and just really refined this down into a science.
Absolutely. So here's my story with progressive anagrams. Mm-hmm. I was driving on a Sunday with my family, mm-hmm. and I got pulled over. And I was going 5 over the speed limit or whatever. It wasn't a huge thing, mm-hmm. but I was pulled over. And the police officer comes over to the window. I opened up my wallet, mm-hmm. and inside I had like my card to wallet or mm-hmm. something. So it had a card in there. And mm-hmm. he goes, "Why do you have poker cards in there?" And I said, "Well, I'm a magician." Mm-hmm. And he goes, "Really?" And he was kind of like
yeah.
disbelieving. And he goes, "Well, can you show me a trick? Can you mm-hmm. do and like prove it or whatever?"
Yeah.
And first thing that came to mind, I was working on one of Atlas Brookings' things with like a Disney movie. Mm-hmm. Had him think of a Disney movie, walked through the anagram, mm-hmm. named the Disney movie that he was thinking of, mm-hmm. and he was taken aback, blown away. And I was lucky enough to get off without a, don't let this get out, don't let his supervisor get out or whatever, but I was lucky enough to get off without a ticket.
Yeah,
so.
It's, you know, it's one of those things, that, again, it's sort of like Tequila Hustler in that for someone who is visually impaired, they can truly experience a moment of direct mind reading because they don't have to write anything down. They don't have to like look at a list. You can literally, there's a number of different categories where you can legitimately say, "Think of this," and then you can get there through this beautiful scripting.
I've used them on stage. I've used them close up. I've used them over the phone.
Yeah.
They work everywhere. It's something that it takes some heavy lifting. Mm-hmm. But if you learn it, you can do it just about anywhere.
I think I totally understand why progressive anagrams is at the top of this list. Well, Josh Birch, thanks so much for taking some time and doing some research to put together a nice list of potential effects that anyone could perform for someone who is visually impaired. If you'd like to find out more about any of the effects that we talked about today, you can visit us on penguinmagic.com, where we have all kinds of fantastic magic training resources for you. Please be sure to like and subscribe, as well as share this on your favorite social media source. My name is Eric Tate. Thanks so much for watching. I'll see you next time.